that's me. I mentioned earlier we had VBS this week. We used this microphone for VBS, and somehow it became a casualty of the week, and so I'll try my best. I'm not sure what we did earlier helped, so I'm not sure what you hooked me up somehow here. I'm not sure. If that doesn't stop, I'm just going to switch to a handheld, because I don't know if that's annoying for you. Is that annoying? It's annoying for me, and I'm the one up here, so.
Well, I mentioned we had VBS this past week, and our theme for the week was the promises of God. And every day we focused on a different promise, God's promise of love, his promise of hope, his promise of salvation, his promise of provision, his promise of power. And it was an absolutely amazing week. Through the course of the week, I mentioned this earlier, we had 11 decisions for Christ. 9 children, 2 teenage leaders gave their lives to Christ as a result of VBS this past week. And so don't ever think VBS is just fun and games with the kids. 11 lives were changed for all of eternity as a result of what happened during VBS, as a result of what God did during VBS this past week. But then, wait, there's more. That's not all. We took up a mission offering every day. And our mission project this week, this past week, same as it was last year, the Moldova Firewood Project. And if you're new to our church, every year we collect up money. I'm getting an echo off this, Josh. I'm not sure if that's just where it is. Every year we collect up money. We send it to that church I mentioned, the Krihanoveki Baptist Church in Moldova, and they purchase firewood for the people in their village. There's some 100 or so extremely, extremely poor people in that village. They live on less than $35 a month, and that's all they have to buy food and medicine, whatever else. And so they don't have money to buy firewood, so we collect money, send it. So that was our mission project again this year. If you weren't reading my newsletters, and I know everybody was, right? Right. So if you weren't, though, let me just kind of fill you in. The kids this week brought in $1,700 to send to Moldova to buy firewood. And so we had a contest, of course, if they made their goal, $1,500, then our VBS director, Elizabeth Olson, got a pie in the face. And so, of course, she got a pie Friday. We set sort of another incentive out there. Instead, if they got over $2,000 for the week, then I'd take a pie, too. And at that point, our deacons conspired against me and threw in $400 to make sure we went over $2,000. So we actually brought in $2,100 for the week to send to Moldova. What an amazing week as God moved through the leaders and through the kids. And all throughout the week, that's why I'm telling you this, is kind of leading somewhere. All throughout the week, we kept coming back to the promises of God. And we made this point to the kids. We said, listen, how do we know that God keeps his promises today? We know that because we read in his word that he kept them then. And we kept coming back to the truth of God's word. And this morning we're starting our August sermon series called Got Questions? That is a question. Do you have questions? And we're looking at some of the critical questions of our day concerning our beliefs. Maybe some of these are questions that you have. Maybe they're questions that other people you'll encounter will have. We're looking this morning at the reliability of the Bible, the question we're asking, can the Bible really be trusted? This is a question that if you haven't been asked as a believer, you will be one day. How can you trust that ancient book? Is it really reliable for us? Next week, we're going to look at the goodness of God and the problem and challenge of suffering and evil in our world. How can those two things coexist? And then we'll look at the person of Jesus and who he was. And then we'll look at, do all roads lead to heaven, or is there just one? But every one of them comes back to this foundational issue of the Word of God. Listen, if the Word of God cannot be trusted, if it's not a reliable witness to us, then none of those, all of those, the beliefs about those other matters are really kind of suspect, because we get them from the Word of God. And so we're going to spend some time this morning looking at this issue of, can the Bible really be trusted? And as we go through this series, it might get a little academic at times, because it is what we call apologetics. Now, I had somebody say to me one time, I don't like that word, apologetics. It sounds like I'm apologizing for my faith. But that's not really what the word means. It's ironic that that's what the word has come to mean in English today, that expressing regret, saying I'm sorry. That's not really what originally the word meant. And in Greek anyway, it comes from the word apologia. It means to make a reasoned argument, to make a reasoned defense of what you believe. That's what apologetics is, being able to reasonably argue and defend what you believe. And so we're going to look at these issues from an apologetic standpoint. It might get a little academic. As we look at this issue of the Bible, we come to being able to make an adequate defense of the Word of God. Now, we don't have enough time in our 30 or so minutes together to cover this issue in its entirety. There's absolutely no way we could. But what I intend to do this Sunday and over the next several Sundays is just give you enough information to make a basic, reasoned defense of what you believe about the Bible and why you believe it. Our text for this morning, sort of our jumping off point, really, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. So if you've got a Bible, I ask you to turn there with me. We're going to use this as sort of the basis, and we'll jump off initially to look at what Paul tells us when he says in that passage that all Scripture is inspired of God. What does that mean? We'll spend a few minutes kind of unpacking that to learn what that means a little bit. And then I want us to look at how the Bible stands up to the challenges. And then really, what does all that mean to us? What are we to do with all of that? And so you've got your Bible open, 2 Timothy chapter 3. Follow along those last two verses, verses 16 and 17. And Paul said, all Scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. As we look at this issue of what the Bible is telling us, what Paul means specifically with that phrase, inspired of God, I want us to ask this question, what is the Bible? I think that's our starting point. When Paul says it's inspired of God, what does that mean to us? What are we to take away from that as far as what the Bible is and what that tells us about what the Bible is to us? That phrase, it's translated here in New American Standard, inspired by God. I think NIV says God breathed. That's probably a closer translation. That's literally what the word means, the breath of God or breathed of God. And there's a lot wrapped up in that little phrase. When we recognize that the Bible is God breathed, that is from the breath of God, we recognize it as what we call the revelation of God. God is revealing himself. That's what a revelation, you even come to the last book in the Bible, the book of the Revelation. It's revealing things that will happen in the end times. And the Bible is God's revelation simply means he's revealing himself to us, making himself known to us in a way that he has not been known or cannot be known any other way. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 that only the Spirit of God knows the thoughts of God. And as we come in and look at this phrase that Paul uses here in 2 Timothy 3, he says that Scripture is from the breath or the Spirit of God. That word can mean breath or spirit. And the Scriptures, the Word of God coming from the Spirit of God, means that what we are reading here, we're reading the heart and the thoughts of God. That's an amazing truth. James said that the Scripture doesn't speak to no purpose. We sang that song a minute ago, Word of God, speak. When we come to the Word of God, the Hebrew writer said the Word of God is active. It's alive. We interact with God when we realize that he is speaking to us, has spoken to us, revealed his heart and his mind and his very spirit to us in his Word. That's an incredible truth. We also, though, note the inspiration. That's the way my translation translates that word, the inspiration of God. That's a good theological term, isn't it? Our doctrinal position says that that's where we stand, that we believe that the Bible is the inspired Word of God. It comes from this passage. What does it mean that the Word of God is inspired? When we use that phrase, we use it in art, right? We use it in music. We use it in literature. And when we use it in those contexts, inspired means somebody who's gifted or talented. We might say, for example, Shakespeare was an inspired writer. Michelangelo was an inspired painter, an artist. We just mean somebody who's incredibly gifted. But when it comes to the Word of God, we're not talking about just gifted religious writers. That's not what we're talking about. The inspiration means that God spoke through these men as they took pen and put it to paper. But it was the Holy Spirit of God that was leading them along, showing them what it is that he wanted them to reveal. In literature, often if there's a politician or a famous athlete or someone who is writing a novel, they'll use what is called a ghost writer. I don't know if you've ever heard of this concept. And I mentioned, if you've been in our church for a while, I mentioned about a year ago, I got in this phase. I don't know where it came from, but it went about as quickly as it came. I got in this phase where I was reading presidential biographies. And I noticed about half of you just fell asleep, just thinking about the concept of reading a presidential biography. I don't know what it was. All of a sudden, I got interested. And I read them for about 6 months, and then it just all of a sudden, the desire dried up. And I realized as I was reading a book that said it was the autobiography of Ronald Reagan, or Decision Points by George W. Bush. So I was reading these books, these autobiographies of presidents. I realized that those men did not sit down at the typewriter or the computer and write those books. They used what is called a ghostwriter. They chose an author. And they chose an author because they liked their personality. They liked their style. They liked the way they did things and the way they wrote, their experiences. And they told their story to that author. And they said, these are the things I want you to write about. This is the message I want you to get across. And then that writer sat down and with their own experience and talent and background and personality, and they wrote that book. And when you look at it on the shelf, it's not the author is not the ghostwriter. The author is the person that passed on the message to them. And in the very same way, not a perfect example, but in the same way, that's the inspiration of the Bible. See, that's one of the common arguments about the Bible. Wasn't it just written by men? I mean, even in church, we acknowledge, well, Paul wrote 2 Timothy. He wrote 13 letters in the New Testament. As we went through the book of Genesis, remember I told you Moses wrote the book of Genesis. Indeed, he wrote the first five books, the Pentateuch. We acknowledge that in church, that a man took a pen to paper or a quill to parchment. He wrote these books. But in the similar way as a ghostwriter, it was God that was speaking through them, literally carrying them along to the destination he wanted them to go through. That's the inspiration. When Paul said that all scripture is inspired of God, that's what he's talking about. Peter said this in 1 Peter chapter 1. He said, for prophecy never had its origin in the human will. But prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. And that phrase, carried along, it really has the idea of wind in a sail. That carries a sailboat along. It takes it to the destination it's supposed to go to. That's the process of inspiration. And when we read the Bible, we come to realize that God is revealing himself, showing himself to us, that he himself is speaking. These are not so much the words of Paul in 2 Timothy as they are the words that God wanted us to know. That's an amazing truth that we come when we realize what the Bible is. And most of the biblical writers seem to understand that they were doing something. This was not their masterpiece they were creating. Over 100 times Moses said in the Pentateuch, in the first five books, he used this phrase, thus says the Lord. Isaiah used it 20 times. Jeremiah over 100. The prophet Ezekiel 60 times. These guys seemed to understand that what they were writing was not their unique original work. These were the very words of God they were passing on. It's an incredible treasure. And God breathed. When we think about the implications of that, that God is revealing himself. He has inspired these words. These are his words. We realize then that the Bible reflects the character of God. The character and the nature of God. I think that's the most logical one, isn't it? You see a painting, if you go out and look at the tables at the silent auction, there's a painting there, and I don't think she's here this morning. Roberta Sargent painted that portrait, that little painting that's out there. It's absolutely beautiful. It's a lake scene with trees. It's gorgeous. But that reflects a little something of her, a little bit of her personality, a little bit of her character went into that. And when we recognize that this is not just some book on the shelf, this is a revelation of the heart and mind of God, his very words. This reflects him, his character. Everything we know about God is true of His Word as well. We know that God is holy. His Word is holy. We know that God cannot lie, therefore His Word cannot lie. We know that God is truth and His Spirit is truth, therefore His Word must be truth. We know that God is a God of perfect integrity. His Word, therefore, must have perfect integrity. Indeed, God Himself is perfect, therefore His Word is perfect. And we realize that the Word of God reflects His very character, His very nature. The Bible is not nearly perfect or mostly true. It is the Word of God. It reflects the very character and nature of God, absolutely perfect and absolutely true. And it stands or falls then as a whole. There are not pieces of God's character that we can say, I like these pieces of God's character, but I'm going to get rid of the rest. And because the Word of God reflects the character of God, then the Word of God stands or falls as a whole. Does that make sense? There aren't parts of the Word of God that we can say, I don't really like that. I'm going to get rid of that piece. I'm going to ignore that section because I don't care for it. I was in a church one time, a little church in Mississippi. I was TDY to Keesler Air Force Base. I went to visit this little country church, and I'd never seen a pastor do this, and I'm certainly not brave enough to do it myself. He got up there one morning, and he said, yeah, you know this piece in the Bible about the virgin birth? I don't really like that. And he tore the page out and crumbled it through on the floor. And he flipped a little further and he said, yeah, you know this part that says that I can't go out and get drunk? I don't really like that. And he tore it out and he crumbled it up and he threw it on the floor. And it's exactly the same reaction all of us had. What in the world are you doing? And he said, you know, when we approach the Word of God as though we can take parts of it and discard other parts, that's exactly what we're doing. We're just tearing pages out and saying, I will accept this piece of the character of God, but I will reject this other piece. Stands or falls as a whole. And I think when we step back and consider what the Bible is, the question is no longer, could the Bible contain a mistake? The question is, could God make one? That's a much larger question. Because the Bible is built on the character of God, and when we step back and realize what the Bible is, what that phrase is telling us, that all Scripture is breathed out by God, we realize what an incredible treasure we possess. That's what the Bible is. This is an apologetics sermon, though. The question really, though, is how does that Bible fare against the critics? Right? Those are the folks that you're going to interact with. Those are the folks that are going to come with the questions. How does the Bible fare against the challenges? I think it's interesting to note that the Bible has been challenged probably more than any other book, any other document ever written. In the 2,000 years, certainly since the New Testament, and many more thousands of years since the Old Testament, there have been challenges historically, challenges scientifically, challenges archaeologically. I don't know if that's a real word, but it is today because I used it. Challenges from all of those fields, and over that course of all of those years and all of those challenges to the Word of God, not one discovery in any of those fields has ever proven anything wrong that's in the Bible. Not one in all of those years. In fact, the things that have been discovered have proven the Bible to be right time and time and time again. And I want us to look this morning just very briefly at some of these challenges, the scientific challenges, in the historical challenge, the archaeological information we've got, to know that when the Bible is questioned, why do you believe that ancient book? We can point to these things and say, these are the reasons I believe it is true, scientifically. I'm not going to go through all of the scientific discoveries, mostly because I'm not smart enough to do that. But every scientific discovery has ultimately supported what the Bible says. There was an American astrophysicist. His name was Robert Jastrow. Robert Jastrow studied the cosmos, studied the universe, spent his life and his career studying physics, and particularly the origin of the universe. Robert Jastrow was an agnostic, though. That means he wasn't really sure whether God existed or not. He passed away in 2008. He knows now. Robert Jastrow made this comment. As he studied the universe, and he studied the origins of the universe, this was the conclusion this agnostic scientist came to. He said, scientists have painted themselves into a corner because by their very own methods, We now know that the universe began abruptly and by forces that we cannot even begin to understand. It has been proven, I think, beyond a doubt, that supernatural forces were indeed at work. An agnostic scientist, as he studied the universe, came to the same conclusion, quite frankly, that Einstein came to. That the more he dug into science, the more he found himself staring at the face of God. That was the way Einstein worded it. And every scientific discovery has ultimately come back to point to the truth of what God has told us all along in his word. And from a historical perspective, there have been challenge upon challenge upon challenge of the historical accuracy of the Bible. Questions raised to say, did the people group really exist? Did that event really take place? Was that leader really in power at that point in time? A couple of years ago, I was in a Facebook debate with a young atheist friend of my niece's. And he brought up what he thought were some of the scientific, or some of the historical, rather, challenges to the Word of God. He said, I don't believe this. There's these parts of history that I don't see line up correctly with the Bible. And he made a profound statement. He's a smart kid. He made this profound statement. He said, if the Bible isn't reliable in history, then how can I trust to get the big issues of eternity right? Profound question. He's absolutely right. If the Bible is God's word, it reflects everything about him, his truthfulness and his integrity, then certainly as the God of history, it would get history right. And there have been historical challenges. Often the miracles and the resurrection are one of the main points of attack of the historical challenges. There's no way those things could have happened. In fact, the argument usually goes like this. Well, nobody really believed those things then. The miracles and the resurrection, those were added later on by the church several centuries later to make people believe, to boost Jesus into being somebody he never was, somebody the early church never believed him to be. There was a man that lived in the first century. His name was Flavius Josephus. Josephus was a Jewish historian, and that's significant for us. He was born in 37 AD. He lived to 101 AD. After the life and ministry of Jesus, but certainly during the apostolic age, he lived. He was Jewish. He was not a believer. He wasn't a follower of Jesus. You remember the Jews didn't accept Jesus as the Messiah. This is what Josephus wrote in his historical account. He wrote, at this time there was a wise man who was called Jesus, and his conduct was good, and he was known to be virtuous. And he was one who wrought surprising feats. Pilate condemned him to be crucified to die. His disciples reported that he had appeared to them after his crucifixion, and that he was alive, and perhaps he was even the Messiah. There was another first century historian, Roman historian named Tacitus, and he said this, Christus, from whom this movement gets its name, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hand of Pontius Pilate. And there are those who will challenge the Bible historically and say, those things, the miracles and the resurrection, were added centuries later. But here we have first century historians, two sources that were not believers. They had no reason to record those things other than the fact that they were true. And what they tell us is that Jesus lived. He was called the Christ or the Messiah, that he was crucified by Pilate, that his disciples believed he did miracles, and they believe he was, in fact, resurrected. From the first century, the historical argument. It's not just those. There's been an argument long in the early chapters of Genesis 21. There's a story about how Abraham and Isaac encounter the Philistines there. And that's long been held up as an inaccurate statement. The Philistines, they say, didn't exist that far back until they discovered a Sumerian text that talked about the existence of sea people. Those were the Philistines. The existence of sea people in exactly that same time frame, in exactly that same place the Bible said they were. The Exodus and the Passover has long been held up as a myth because they said there's no record of Hebrew people ever being in Egypt. But then there were Egyptian hieroglyphs that were discovered that confirmed the presence of Hebrews in ancient Egypt. In 2010, an Egyptologist, she printed her research findings. In her findings, she found a scroll, an ancient Egyptian scroll that described in almost exact detail the plagues that the Bible talks about, that led up to the Passover and ultimately to the Exodus. historical evidence, one after the other, that supports the claims of God's word. And archaeologically, as archaeologists have gone out and dug up and found things in ancient societies, this archaeological evidence supports the word of God. What they have found over the course of time, 5,700 manuscripts of the Bible in Greek, 10,000 in Latin, 15,000 in other languages, some dating back as far as maybe the middle of the second century, even late first century. Now, from a historical perspective, that's enormous. That's unprecedented. The Gaelic Wars are recorded, but the earliest written record of those wars is 1,000 years after it took place. And here with our manuscripts, pieces of manuscripts and portions of the Gospels that exist that are dated back to maybe even the end of the first century, within just a few years of the events that they record. That's amazing. And as the Bible that we hold today, as this has been compared to those manuscripts and those fragments and those pieces that have been discovered, as the Bible that we hold today is being compared to these ancient documents, we're finding that this word, 95% or better accurate to what we're finding in those old manuscript pieces. Well, they are finding, I found nothing, but they're finding in those old manuscript pieces. The archaeology points plainly to the truth that what we have today is the same thing that they had, that when Paul put pen to paper in the first century and wrote 2 Timothy, it's the same thing that we have today. God has ensured his word has been transmitted accurately. And there are hundreds of these kinds of finds. Cities and ancient peoples, where and when the Bible said they were going to be. That hieroglyphic evidence of the Exodus in Egypt. The pools at Bethesda and Siloam discovered just like they were described in the Gospels. Over and over and over again. Now, if you want to do a little more digging on this, I just hit on some of the highlights. If you want to do some more digging, there are a couple of books I will recommend. The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel. It's a great book that helps you dig into some of these proofs. And Evidence That Demands a Verdict by Josh McDowell. Both of these books help you dig in and really get a good sense of all of the list of evidence that has been discovered that supports the Bible scientifically, historically, archaeologically. Well, very quickly, what does all this mean? Well, first of all, if the Bible is the Word of God, it means it's our absolute authority in life. God is the ultimate authority in the universe, means that His Word is the absolute authority in our lives. I mentioned before, we don't have the ability to treat the Bible like an a la carte buffet line. And I'll just load up on the pieces that I like and I'll ignore the things that I don't. We don't have that authority to do that. The Bible is the Word of God, means it is the absolute authority in our lives. Second, the Bible judges us. We don't judge it. We don't have the ability to come to the Word of God and say, this is not right. This should not be here. The Hebrew writer said that the Bible pierces to the heart of man. It judges the heart of man. We don't have the authority or the right to judge the Word of God. It's not reinterpreted with societal trends or what is politically correct. Society and societal trends need to bow to God and His Word. The Word doesn't bow to society. The Bible is the Word of God, means it reflects His character, which means it's sufficient for our lives. It doesn't tell us everything we want to know, right? Come to the Word of God, and boy, I'd like to know how to deal with my neighbors whose stereo is turned up too loud. But I'm not finding that on these pages. It doesn't tell us everything we want to know, but it does tell us everything we need to know. It is sufficient for our lives. And lastly, is this, I'll switch my little atheist friend's argument around. That since the Bible is accurate in small things, we can trust it in the big things of eternity. The Bible is an incredible treasure. And to realize that we have the very Word of God has tremendous meaning for us. It means that God loves us enough to show Himself to us. It means that we can know Him in a real and personal way. It means that we can trust and rely on Him. More importantly than what it means is what we do with all of that. It'd be a shame to have such an incredible treasure and let it sit on our shelf and just collect dust in our home. To never interact with it, never come to know who this God is. God has taken the step to reveal himself to us, and the question then for us is, what will we do with that? Will you pray with me? Father, we are just so amazed that you loved us enough to reveal yourself in your word. And Father, as we encounter people who question your word, challenge your word, help us to point to the truths that help us know that the Bible that we hold in our hand is reliable and accurate. And yes, it can be trusted. Father, in just a moment, we're going to gather around this table and celebrate your Lord's Supper. Celebrate your crucifixion on the cross, your broken body and shed blood for us. And Father, as we do that, I just pray that this is a time, it's not a time of a ritual that we go through. It's a time of worship, a time of celebration, a time of seeing you for who you are and recognizing and celebrating your love for us. Father, would you bless us, continue to bless us in these next few moments as we come before your table. We pray it in Jesus' name.